हेलो गाइस, वेलकम टू अनदर सेशन ऑफ आरबीआई 24/7। माय नेम इज मानसी आनंद एंड आई वेलकम यू टू दिस न्यू सेशन। सो गाइस, जैसे कि आपने देखा होगा दैट इन अंडर दिस सीरीज आरबीआई 24/7 वी हैव डिस्कस्ड ऑलमोस्ट ऑल द मेजर क्राइसिस ऑफ द वर्ल्ड, बी इट ग्लोबल फाइनेंशियल क्राइसिस, यू नो यूरोजोन क्राइसिस, ग्रेट डिप्रेशन, राइट? सो और द एनबीएफसी क्राइसिस व्हिच इंडिया इज फेसिंग रिसेंटली। सो हियर we are taking another crisis which holds some significance in the world, which led to so many changes in the and reforms in the economic structures of the country. And this crisis is closer to home, because agar hum global financial crisis ya eurozone ki baat kare to they were not having so much of impact on India as compared to the western and european nations, but this crisis, this is a little closer to home. This is this belongs to the countries who are our neighbors, right? So I'm talking about the Asian financial crisis. So let's discuss about it. But before doing that, I would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel and do not forget to press this bell icon if you want to get notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. Now moving ahead to the crisis. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. Okay. Also called the Asian contagion. Guys, before starting up with this session, I would like to tell you that jitni terms hum yahan pe discuss karenge, many terms that we are going to discuss, they have already been discussed in separate questions, in separate sessions. So if you are unaware of any term, do let us know in the comments, because you can ask for its meaning or you can ask for the link of the video in which that particular word was discussed, right? So this Asian financial crisis, it is also known as Asian contagion. Contagion ka matlab it's very simple. Just as you can get COVID-19 from one person to another, crisis can spread from one country to another, right? So the spread of economic disturbances from one territory to another territory is known as contagion, right? Sequence of currency devaluations and other events. So if you remember, जैसे कि global financial crisis में सबसे पहले asset bubble हुआ था, real estate asset bubble था. Here the major problem was that many Asian countries, they saw their currencies getting devalued, or the value of their currencies falling in relation to other currencies of the world, right? And this was a really significant fall which made investors lose confidence in those countries, right? Began in the summer of 1997, spread through many Asian markets, affected many Asian countries including South Korea, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia and others as well. See what is special about these crises is that these are the countries which were being called Asian tigers in the previous decade, because they were growing at such a fast rate. If we consider countries like South Korea or Malaysia or Indonesia, right? So some of them were being called Asian cubs, which were growing relatively slower, and some of them which were growing at a really fast rate, they were known as Asian tigers, right? So these countries which were experiencing a super high growth rate, the sudden fall in the value of their currency was significant, and that is why it needs to be studied that what were the certain factors that made those currencies fall or get devalued, right? So they lost about 70% of their value. See, apart from being a financial crisis, it was a crisis of politics at different level of politics, because some political angles hold specific importance here that we are going to discuss further. Now coming to the Asian tigers, a little background of the decade which was previous to the decade of crisis. So the crisis took place in 1997, and if we talk about the previous decade, which was 1980 to 1990, You can also include the other 5 years to 1995. In this period, these economies, they saw huge growth rates. The four Asian tigers, which were South Korea, Taiwan, Singapore and Hong Kong. Apart from these, there were some Asian cub economies which were also growing, but not as fast as them, but yes, having a significant growth rate, but have experienced rapid growth over the last several years. Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam, Philippines. So these are some countries which have seen significant growth, right? So between 1960s and 90s, these Asian tigers, they underwent rapid industrialization. See, ek point jo in sub economies mein, most of the economies mein common tha, wo tha export-led growth. That means inki jo growth ho rahi thi, wo isiliye ho rahi thi, because they were manufacturing at such a fast rate and their prices were low because of availing the benefit of economies of scale. And they were led by export. So, maal banao aur maal becho. Maal banao aur maal becho. They were following this strategy which was being followed by China as well. Right? So, this export-led growth was the basic factor behind the change in these economies. Here you can see rapid industrialization and they maintained exceptionally high growth rates of more than 7% a year. Injections of large amount of foreign investment. So obviously baat hai, whenever a country grows at such a fast rate, investors, they look to invest in the countries and they think that we should invest in this particular country because it is going to give you really good returns. So recently the movie White Tiger has released. I don't know how many of you have watched, but if you either have read that book and or you have watched the movie, you must be knowing that how the decade which the movie talks about, they were talking about India and China as the growing powers and why foreign investors, they want to invest here, right? Similarly, what India and China were experiencing after 2000s, these economies, they experienced between this period. So, there was a huge inflow of foreign investment into these countries. Okay, between the late 1980s and early to mid 1990s before the crisis. Nations experienced a financial crisis in 1907 and 1998 stemmed from the huge debt servicing expenses and inequitable distribution of wealth. So this is one major point, inequitable distribution of wealth. Although these countries were growing, they were having profits, their companies were making profits, but the wealth was not being divided equally. That means country mein sare classes ke paas equal rate se paisa nahi ja raha tha. The rich were becoming richer and the poor were becoming poorer, right? So as the movie White Tiger says, the society was divided into two classes, one having big bellies and the other one having huge amounts of hunger, right? So some similar situation can be put into these countries as well, that the big businessmen, jitne bhi paise wale log the, bade businessmen the, wo to bahut paisa kama rahe the, but the other people, the public, the general public, which was huge in population, huge in numbers, they were not getting that much of money. So wealth was concentrated in the hands of certain people. As we can see in India also, that obviously the companies, they make profit and they show good profits on their balance sheets, but there is a limited number of companies who are having that much of money. Most of the small businessmen, most of the small factories, they are just struggling for liquidity, they are struggling for financial help. Moving ahead, so this was about Asian tigers. Okay, coming to the causes leading to the crisis. First of all the other crises of the world, this crisis also stemmed from asset bubbles. Because see, if foreign investors are showing that much of interest in a country, then obviously they are going to speculate, they are going to infuse so much of money that it is going to lead in price, it is going to lead in rise of prices of different assets in the country. And it might not be an increase in the fundamentals, but those prices, they were just led by the action of foreign investors. Is paise ko, ye jo paisa aata hai foreign investors ke through in a country, we call it hot money. Hot money means money which has a lot of movement, which has a lot of volatility. That means as soon as it comes into your country, it can move out very soon, right? So these foreign investors, if they see an opportunity, obviously they are going to rush in your country. But if they see a hint of threat, a hint of risk, then they are going to run back, right? So that is why this money is called hot money. Hot money can be a good thing for the development of underdeveloped countries or the developing countries. But government should figure out a way that you should attract hot money and you should retain it. उनके एग्जिट को इतना आसान नहीं बनाना चाहिए, बिकॉज सी इफ दे एंटर योर कंट्री दे आर गोइंग टू ब्रिंग अ लॉट ऑफ लिक्विडिटी एंड इफ दे गो बैक दे विल टेक ऑल द लिक्विडिटी लीविंग द कंट्री इन रूइंस, राइट? सो द ऑब्जेक्टिव शुड बी टू अट्रैक्ट दिस सॉर्ट ऑफ मनी एंड टू रिटेन इट, नॉट लेट इट मूव आउट ऑफ द कंट्री. So asset bubbles because of the action of foreign investors and the entry of hot money. Growth in regions, export economies led to high levels of FDI. Obviously these economies were export economies, so there was existence of foreign direct investment, and also the businessmen, they were taking lots of loans, they were expanding their production, expanding their capabilities so that they can fulfill this demand, they can fulfill all the exports, they can fulfill all the orders of exports that they were doing. Led to soaring real estate values, bolder corporate spending. Sorry, obviously, see, even today also, if we compare it with India, when the stock markets are rallying, people are asking their friends, people are asking their consultants that whether we should invest now, whether we should put money into stock market or not. But do remember that markets are rallying. I'm sorry. And this can be a result of a swift action of investors rather than the fundamentals, right? So whenever the prices are rising, it gives a good signal. It gives a good signal to investors, it gives a good signal to businesses that go on spending, go on expanding. And if they spend, obviously, kahan se spend karenge, paisa kahan se layenge? They have to take loans, they have to take debt. Usually they take debt from the banks. I hope you all remember the Nirav Modi case and the Vijay Mallya case. Both of them took loans, huge loans from the banks, and that too from the public sector banks, and fled with their money. So led to soaring real estate values, even large public infrastructure projects. So corporates to kharcha kar hi rahe the, but uske sath sath sarkare bhi kam nahi thi. Even governments were taking a lot of loans and they were also spending in the country to carry on this speed of development. So there was a lot of public infrastructure, public spending also. Heavy borrowing from banks provided most of the funding. US Federal Reserve also began to raise the interest rates around this time to counteract inflation. Now coming to the action of US. Now you must be thinking that we have been talking about the Asian economies. It's sab mein US kahan se aaya beech mein? US has a relevance here, and that we are going to talk about how. Now on a different note, US recently, in this time period, in that time period, US had some agreement with certain countries which was called the Plaza Accord. Right? And US was also experiencing inflation that time. Now, whenever a country experiences inflation, what does it do? It can increase the interest rates, and that is the same thing that US did. US ne kya kiya? Interest rates bada diye inflation ko control karne ke liye. But how did the change by US impact these other economies? I'll tell you how. This was because when they increased their interest rate, the hot money which was invested into these emerging economies, these Asian tigers, it's went straight back to the US to take the benefit of these increased interest rates, right? So this money which usually comes from the West into emerging economies for the higher interest rate. Guys, we have discussed that emerging economies, they have higher interest rates to support the growth, right? So as US increased the interest rate, this money which was here invested here went straight back to the US. And that is why I was telling you, as soon as this money comes, it can also go back with the same speed. And this obviously created problems for these countries because they had taken huge loans because of this money that was entering into the markets, because of this flush of liquidity. And now they were in problem. Because agar bahut sare log in emerging, bahut sare investors in emerging economies ke assets ko chhod kar wapis se dollar denominated assets khareedenge ya fir US ke assets khareedenge, then obviously other investors are going to doubt their investments in emerging economies, right? So this can start an attack on a particular country, on a particular country's currency, right? So this is how the increase of interest rates by US created problems for the Asian countries. Okay, now fall of the tigers. Talking about how did it start and what happened when it happened, right? Rise in the interest rates by US created problems for the currencies. If the countries which were pegged to US dollars, for the countries which were pegged to the US dollars, led to a fall in exports and less investment. So, abhi to humne ek baat kari ke paisa jo tha wo wapis US mein chala gaya nikal ke. Now, there is one other aspect of this, that see, if money is going back to US and investors are once again buying the dollar denominated assets, then obviously the value of dollar is going to increase, right? And emerging economies se investors ne paisa nikala tha US mein dalne ke liye. So the currencies of these countries, they are going to fall and dollar is going to appreciate. Now many of currencies of these countries, they were pegged to US dollar. Pegged ka matlab linked, although we have discussed the meaning of pegged in one of our previous sessions. Pegged matlab simply linked. So many of these countries' currencies were linked to dollar. So agar dollar badega, to obviously unka bhi price bad jayega in relation to other countries. And us increase ko maintain karne ke liye, in economies ki governments ko, they would have to create a demand for their currencies. But when investors are taking their money back and putting downward pressure on your currency, how can you lift your currency up? You can lift your currency up by creating a demand for it, by buying your own currency and selling dollars. But uske liye aapko chahiye hote hain foreign reserves. Uske liye you need to have dollars so that you can sell dollars and buy your own currency and try to cover this pressure which is being put upon you by the foreign investors. These emerging economies, they were not able to maintain it because the amount of dollars they had, they tried to sell it, buy their own currencies back so that they can make their currencies appreciate in relation to this dollar. But it was very difficult because kitne foreign reserves honge, jitne honge utne hi to kharch karenge. And once they are exhausted, then they will not be able to maintain this peg, right? So one problem was this, and obviously you can see here. So ye jo appreciation tha US dollar ka, isko maintain karne ke liye, these countries had to create an artificial appreciation of their own currencies, and this artificial appreciation made the exports fall, and the foreign investors who were losing confidence, they were pulling their money out, and there was a fall in exports because of this artificial appreciation, right? So investors, they were putting downward pressures, authorities trying to lift the currencies up, but and in turn they are making their exports fall. And these countries, they were based on an export led growth model. So everything was in a chaos, everything was in a mess, right? So I hope now you are clear with this. Moving to the another point. Now this was also supported by some failures of big companies in Thailand, like a very big property developer, and bankruptcy of थाईलैंड वन ऑफ द बिगेस्ट फाइनेंस कंपनीज. सो थाईलैंड की एक बहुत बड़ी रियल एस्टेट कंपनी एंड फाइनेंस कंपनी दे फेल, दे एनकाउंटर्ड फेलियर. एंड ऑब्वियसली अगर इन्वेस्टर्स ऑलरेडी इनके एसेट्स को बेच रहे हैं, इन्वेस्टर्स आर पुलिंग देयर मनी बैक, सो देन दीज फेलियर्स दे आर ऑब्वियसली गोइंग टू सपोर्ट द एक्शन ऑफ इन्वेस्टर्स हु आर फ्लीइंग द कंट्रीज, राइट? सो दीज फेलियर्स दे ऑल्सो क्रिएटेड सम प्रॉब्लम्स. Now, the tipping point, the starting point was realization that Thailand's investors, that the rate of appreciation in the country's properties values had stalled and its rise levels were unsustainable. Now, the investors, they realized that country ke fundamentals mein itna jaan nahi hai, Thailand ke fundamentals mein itna koi dam nahi hai, but there was creation of some asset bubbles, and that is why the liquidity which was brought in by hot money that were making the prices rise, and now prices are going to collapse once this money is going back. Out of this, investors, the other investors who were believing in the country, they also pulled their money back. Guys, ye na self-sustainable models hote hain. If investors think that a country is going to go down, they can make that country go down because sara paisa country se wapas khinch lenge. But if they think country is going to sustain, although country mein kitni bhi problems ho, if they think the country will sustain, the country will grow and keep putting money into it, then anyhow the country is going to sustain, right? So there were certain problems. We are not saying that Thailand was not having any problems, but these problems compounded with the rise in interest rates by US, by fall in exports and the action on investors, all these factors made the investors lose confidence in Thailand's currency, and all of them pulled their money back. And they pulled their money back, then Thailand's government was unable to maintain that peg. They had to let it float to devalue and let it get devalued. So these after that, currency traders began attacking the Thai baht's peg to US dollar. So Thailand ki currency Thai baht. So this was pegged to US dollar. This proved successful and currency was eventually floated and devalued because it was not at all equivalent to dollar. That is why their central banks were not able to maintain that peg, and they had to let go. Following this devaluation, ek bar Thailand ka devaluation hua, then people started thinking ki agar ek Asian country, investors started thinking ki ek Asian country mein problem hai, to aspas ki sari countries mein problem hoga. Then they started attacking Malaysian ringgit, Indonesian rupiah and Singapore dollar and moved sharply lower. So all these currency, the value of these currencies also started creating problems. See, till now these countries were going fine. Every country has its own set of problems, financial difficulties. Koi country perfect to hoti nahi hai. But when investors started pulling their money back, these problems amplified. Their businesses started facing problems because investors ne paisa wapis khich liya, and they were leading to failures. If businesses are leading to failures, then banks face problem. So everything is interconnected, right? So this happened because of the action of investors, because the investors, they lost their confidence in these currencies. These devaluations led to high inflation and a host of problems that spread as wide as South Korea and Japan. Now the value of these currencies, it was falling sharply, and they had taken debt. I told you that their expenditure was being funded by taking debt. So they had usually taken debts in foreign currencies and most probably US dollars. And now their currencies were falling in respect to dollars. So earlier, agar unko ek US dollar ke badle mein, let's say Malaysia hai, earlier agar inko ek US dollar ke badle mein 100 ringgit dene hote the, to now after devaluation they had to pay 100 ringgit. Guys, this is just an example, not connected with the actual statistics, right? So now you see their debt burden is increasing because their currency is going down, their currency is getting devalued, right? So that increased their debt and increased the prices of their imports. When imports increase, it led to high inflation because cost of manufacturing was increased, all the manufacturers who were importing machinery, importing raw materials from other countries, they were having to pay a huge amount of money for buying anything denominated in foreign assets, led to high inflation, and all of these financial problems, they started spreading. Inflation ka problem ho gaya, debt high ho gaya, and companies and banks, they started facing problems. Investors pulled their money out. So all of these things were happening. Here you can see the fall. So there are 5 countries: Indonesia, Thailand, Korea, Philippines and Malaysia. You can see the sudden fall in their exchange rates. Guys, if you want, you can also take a screenshot of it. Okay. Now, which were the problems that were getting highlighted in this? Right. First of all, the export-led growth strategy. Focusing on increasing your exports. This is obviously a good thing, but the entire dependence on exports, you should have created demand in your own country also. You should have maximum kya ho raha tha ki jitni bhi manufacturing ho rahi thi, they were getting out of the country. But agar country ke under hi demand hoti, phir exports fall ho jayenge, to bahut zyada farak nahi padega, because you know that the demand is within the country, right? So apart from focusing on exports, the government should also focus on creating demand within their own country by their own people. Involves close government cooperation. Now, agar companies ko itna manufacture karna hai that they can have the benefits of economies of scale and they can manufacture at lower cost so that their exports increase, they need to have good connections with the government. So one problem which came out was crony capitalism. Guys, this has also been discussed in one of our previous session. It certainly means government trying to favor their own people, governments trying to favor certain business persons or certain business houses who are close to them, right? Agar ek sarkar hai, wo sirf ek company ko focus karegi, baaki companies ko chhod diya jaye, it can be in any sector, be it telecom sector or any other sector. You can compare it with your own country also, that if this happens, then the competition is going to get cut and one company is going to dominate the market, right? So the point is, such level of economic growth obviously requires business persons to have some connections with government, and this problem of crony capitalism, business person having good relations with government, bribing government officials for carrying out their tasks, this came out as a severe problem in the Asian countries. So governments who used to provide them with subsidies, favorable financial deals and currency pegged to US, these were certain problems which came out. So obviously these certain things, they benefited growing industries. It also involved certain risks. What were the risks? That explicit and implicit government guarantee. See, agar business ko government guarantee deti hai, we have learned about the sovereign guarantee term, that if government gives guarantee to a certain business venture, to a certain business debt, it is obviously beneficial for the business because they are going to get loans at the lower rates. But the problem involved here is, there is one certain problem, that if that company fails, and if many companies like these fails, government would have to face that financial burden, right? So when many of the companies, they started failing, government had to bail them out, fulfill their guarantees, which created financial difficulties for the government as well. So cozy relationships between East Asian conglomerates and governments and banks, financial institutions, regulators, and a wash of foreign financial inflows with little attention to potential risks. Basically, obviously there was some level of reckless lending, giving loans to business persons without thinking that whether they will be able to pay it back or not, just giving them loans so that they can expand their facilities. All contributed to massive moral hazard in East Asian economies. Moral hazard means banks were lending recklessly, governments were trying to, businesses taking benefit of government. Moral hazard means not thinking what is right or wrong and just thinking about what is profitable, right? So all these things led to moral hazard of businesses, and this problem of crony capitalism, the friendship between business houses and the government, this was being cited as one of the major reasons for the fall of Asian tigers. And this was also one, surprisingly, this was also one of the reason which was behind the sudden growth of Asian tigers and Asian economies. So money going into major investments going into potentially unsound projects. Okay. Other problems, reversal of Plaza Accord and US dollar appreciate relative to yen and Deutsche Mark. So basically appreciation, US appreciation ne kaise problems create ki, that we all learnt about, because then the economies, the Asian economies were not able to maintain the peg that with the appreciating US dollar, right? Led to major financial pressure accumulating in this economies as Japanese and German exports became more and more competitive with East, other East Asian exports. Guys, now this is a point which we should look at. Okay, US dollar was appreciating. So I told you that US had some sort of agreement which was called Plaza Accord. According to this Plaza Accord, US, Germany and Japan, right? So US, Germany and Japan, they said that we are going to let the dollar appreciate, right? Once the dollar appreciated, German mark and Japanese yen, they became cheaper. And when they became cheaper, obviously their exports became more competitive. Once they became more competitive, they started competing with this, these Asian economies which were surviving on the growth-led model, export-led growth model, right? So, with the appreciation of US, Asian countries ki currencies mehengi ho gai, jo ki US dollar se linked thi, unki currencies mehengi hone ki wajah se exports gir gai. And German mark and Japanese yen, because of their depreciation, their goods became more competitive. So, exports slumped and corporate profits declined. East Asian governments and connected financial institutions found it increasingly difficult to borrow in US dollars. Now these Asian governments, jinko pehle easily loan mil rahe the because of their growth, now they were not able to take these loans, right? To subsidize their domestic industries and to maintain their currency pegs, they were not able to take the loans. These pressures came to a head in 1997, one after another, they abandoned their pegs and devalued their currencies. So, ek ke baad ek country ne apne pegs ko tod diya. They were not able to maintain the pegs. Their currencies devalued, fell in comparison to dollar, and investors pulled their money out. Okay, coming to the recovery mode. There's nothing much here. Recovery mode, IMF came, IMF ne interfere kiya and it said that it is going to give monetary packages to these Asian countries which were facing problems, right? So roughly $110 billion they were given in form of short term loans to Thailand, Indonesia and South Korea. But there was a condition attached. IMF said, we are giving you loans, now you have to maintain your countries, or countries mein jo bhi sab galat harkate chal rahi hai usko band karna padega, right? So unhone kya kiya, strict conditions laga di and governments ko bola ke taxes bada do taki tumhare paas zyada revenue aaye, increase your taxes so that you can collect more revenue and drop the expenditure, right? Reduce your public spending so that you can save more money. But the problem is, in an economy which is already hit by recession, which is already facing problems, agar aap taxes bada doge aur public spending nahi karoge, then obviously the problems are going to worsen in nature rather than becoming better, right? So many of the countries, they were affected, they started to show signs by 1999. So some experts believe that IMF ne ye sahi nahi kiya inko bolkar ke taxes bada do, rather they should be spending more in an economy which is already crisis hit, right? So there is some sort of spat between the Asian economies and IMF, because Asian economies think that hamare saath ye cheez theek nahi hui when we were in problem, and they think that the crisis that these Asian economies faced, that was not because of some major problem, that was just because of the action of investors, because investors started losing confidence. Thailand se is crisis ki starting hui, but even those countries say ki choti moti problems to sari countries mein hoti hain, and what we faced was not because of our weak fundamentals, it was because of the action of investors, and that is why we face certain problems, and we should not be forced to have this austerity measures. So that there's a little spat, a conflict, right? So, and in fact many economists, they believe that whatever happened here with the Asian economies, that was not majorly because of their fundamentals, but just because of loss of investor confidence, right? You can see here. So here guys, there is a timeline, you can see, you can take a screenshot and then read it later. I hope it's readable. Yes, it's readable. Right, you can take a screenshot. Just tells you the different actions, the different activities that took place on different dates. So guys, this was all about the Asian crisis. With this, I think we are done with all the major crises, economic crisis of the world. And if there are any doubts about this, you can definitely mention them on the video. I'll see you in the next session. Until then, you guys take care of yourself, and thank you for being here.